In this lesson, we are going to learn about solubilities, and specifically, we are going to look at the rules of solubility. To understand solubility, we need to look at the terms soluble and insoluble. When a compound is soluble, that is, it's being dissolved by a solvent, or by, in this case, specifically, when we look at solubility, we look specifically as the substance being dissolved by water molecules, because water is the most common solvent that we have. In this case, if a substance is soluble, it is being dissolved by water molecules into aqueous ions instead of remaining as a solid. What does that mean? For example, let's say I have this compound right here, some random compound, okay? The way it works when a compound being dissolved by water is that it will break the ions, just because these are compounds being dissolved by water. And how does it work is that the water molecule will surround the ions, so therefore this ions will never go back to, it try to get in, but it doesn't work because it's being surrounded by water molecules. And the same thing over here as well. It will be surrounded by a bunch of water molecules in a different direction. So keep that in mind. And then this ion will try to get in here, which is also surrounded by water molecule as well. So just do that. How about that? So therefore, it remains as an ion in an aqueous form. There's no way it's going to go back together as a solid. Where if a compound is insoluble, this compound remains as a solid. And how does it work is that sometimes when we have ions like this, okay, and they are being separated by water molecules, the attractive force between the two charges is so strong that it will separate the water molecules and become a solid. And now the force between this, the electrostatic force between these two, or the ionic bond specifically, is so strong that the water molecule come in, it will not break this at all. It will let this remain as a solid, and this will become a precipitate if we have a bunch of this solid form. So that's the definition of precipitate. Basically, a solid in a solution. Okay? So that's the difference between soluble and insoluble. When a compound is insoluble, the strong force between these two ions is so strong that the water molecule can never separate it. Where if it's soluble, this force is not strong enough. The water molecule come in and split them two ions, and now they are being surrounded by water molecule, and they never get together ever again until we change some condition. But that is for another topic. Now let's get back to memorize the solubility rules. That's where it gets tricky, okay? However, the most difficult part of solubilities is memorizing the solubility rules, because if we don't know the rules of solubility, there's no way we can solve any problem that relate to solubilities. But the good thing is that we have this memory device that allows us to memorize most of the common solubility rules. It's all coming back to this picture right here. We have a student with saggy pants right here. You can see their underwear is kind of sewing off and the pants kind of falling apart, saggy. Now, we can look at this student, we can notice right. Now, we have this picture. When you think of the solubility rule, think of this picture of a student have a sagged pants. To memorize the solubility rules, we think of this student right here with a saggy pants. In this case, if you are in a school environment, the teacher always, notice always, they always nag about student who has saggy pants. In this case, we can simplify this into, in school, the teachers always. This is referring to always soluble. Okay, so the rules only apply to always soluble with a few exceptions. So in school, the teacher always nag, okay, N-A-G, at the students who sag. So in this case, this student who is sag will be nagged by the teacher always. Now, notice how I divide into two parts. So for nag is always, that means the teacher always nags, so therefore it's always soluble. And the N represent nitrate. So any compound has nitrate in it will be always soluble. Then we have A for acetate. So any compound with acetate will always be soluble. And any compound with the ions of group 1A will always be soluble. Now let's get back to at the students who say. This is where it gets tricky, because if we continue to read, it says except for SNG with LMS. So let's go back and talk about the S. S is for sulfate. So any compound will always be soluble when it has sulfate in it, except with the condition of LMS. What does L stand for? L is for lead. What does M stand for? M is for mercury, Hg2, 2 plus. And then S is for silver, which is, we already know, Ag plus. And for lead, we know that it is Pb2 plus, okay? So that's LMS. So the LMS only applies to S and G. Now let's go back and look at this. Then we have A in SAG for ammonium. Any compound with ammonium will always be soluble. Then we have the second G, in this case, for group 7A, which is the halogen. So in this case, for group 7A, we have to use the exception, which in this case, with LMS. So when the ions in group 7A bond with LMS, it will be insoluble. But when it's bonded with something else, it will be soluble. The same thing with sulfate. Sulfate is always soluble, okay, always. Sulfate is always soluble, except for with LMS. But sulfate is also tricky as well, because when it's bonded with calcium, strontium, and barium, this will always be insoluble. That's the only thing that's tricky about sulfate. So when sulfate bond with calcium, strontium, and barium, it will be insoluble, the same thing with the LMS. So keep that in mind, okay? Let's look at specific compound. In this case, we look at task number 2. Determine if the compounds will form aqueous ions or will remain a solid. So first of all, let's look at sodium chloride. Oh, look at that. That is in group 1A. So we know that right away it is always soluble. So when it's soluble, it's going to become an ion. We know that's going to be in aqueous. Well, and Cl, of course, will also be in aqueous form as well. What about lead nitrate? Remember, we have the exception with lead, LMS. But in this case, we go back to rule number 1, nitrate. Any compound with nitrate will always be soluble, so therefore it will form ions, specifically aqueous ions, Pb2+, aqueous, and NO3- aqueous. So still being a solid, it will form two separate ions, just like sodium chloride. And if you remember, when you put table salt in water, what happened? It disappeared. That tells you that it's being dissolved into aqueous ions. We cannot see the ions because it's too small. And then we have lead chloride. Notice how lead is part of LMS, and then the chlorine is from group 7A. So that tells you, although chlorine is always soluble, but when it bonds with lead, it will not be soluble. So in this case, it's going to remain as a solid or as a precipitate. Then we have calcium fluoride. Calcium, we don't have any rule for calcium, but we have fluorine right here, or the F, which is in group 7A. And again, group 7A will always be soluble except with LMS. Calcium is not part of LMS, so therefore this will be dissolved into calcium ions in aqueous form, and then fluoride ions in aqueous form as well. So that's how we determine if a compound is going to be soluble or insoluble. Now let's look at task number 1. In this case, we look at two ions. So to determine if two ions will remain as aqueous ion or will form precipitate. That is, now we have two solutions that contain two separate ions and we mix them together. Well, this ion will combine together to make a solid or does remain as an ion forever. In this case, we have sodium aqueous and chloride aqueous. Well, these two combine together to make a solid. Based on the solubility rules, any element with group 1A will remain soluble. So therefore, they will not form a solid. So they're going to form, in this case, aqueous ions, or remain as an aqueous ion. So in this case, they will remain as aqueous ions. Let's look at the next one. We have chloride and silver ions. In this case, what we have here is chlorides come from group 7A, which is always soluble with the exception of LMS, lead, mercury, and silver. Oh, there you go, that's the silver. So that means it will become insoluble. So when you mix a solution with chloride and silver ions, they will combine together to form a solid, which we know is going to be the positive always first, so AgCl. And they will form precipitate as a solid right there. So they will form a solid precipitate instead of remaining as aqueous ions, as in sodium and chloride right there. Then we have ammonium sulfide. So in this case, ammonium is coming back to this rules right here. Ammonium has no exception. So anything that's bonded with ammonium, of course, is always soluble. So therefore, this two, well, we know right away it's gonna be remain as aqueous ions. And then right here on the bottom, we have hydroxide and sodium. Again, anything that go back to group 1A will be soluble. So of course we know it is going to be aqueous ions. And that's how we know if two solutions of different ions, and when we mix the two solutions together, will they make us precipitate based on solubility rules. Let's try another pump together. In this case, I have calcium hydroxide. Wait a minute, I don't have anything with calcium. So what happens when we see a compound that does not apply to the rules? We have to assume which is the opposite of always solubles. Of course, gonna be insoluble. For instance, we have calcium hydroxide. It doesn't apply to any of the rules right here. So therefore, we know it's gonna remain as a solid, because you either always soluble or the other way is insoluble. So we know this one doesn't apply to any of the rules, so therefore it's remaining as a solid. How about lead sulfate? Do we have any rule about lead? With the exception of group 7A and sulfate. But in this case, we have sulfate. Oh, right there. So for sulfate, with the exception of S and G with LMS, so therefore it's going to become a solid, because sulfate is always soluble except with calcium, strontium, barium, and with LMS. So therefore, in this case, it's going to combine together to form a solid. So we have PbSO4 as a solid right there. Beautiful. And this is the precipitate we will see in the solution if we mix them together. What about barium sulfate? We have sulfate. Oh, there you go. And then barium. So barium, remember, when sulfate bond with barium, it's become insoluble. So therefore, it's going to become a solid. In this case, we have BaSO4, and that's going to become a solid. And then we have mercury chloride. Remember, chloride is in group 7A, with the exception of S and G with LMS. So what we have in this case, mercury combined with chloride and form a solid. Because group 7A with LMS will become insoluble. And therefore, we have Hg2Cl2, and that will become a solid. And that is how you apply the solubility rules. Always think about saggy pants, and the teacher will always nag at the student who sag, except with S and G with LMS, specifically sulfate with calcium, strontium, and barium. And good luck with that.